Hi, everybody. Thank you for coming to this very exciting panel that is about to start. I'm Natalia Mount, and I'm the Executive Director of ProArts. And when asked to prepare a conversation as part of this wonderful fair, the stARTup fair, I thought that the best conversation that we can have at this point in time, and especially in connection to what's happening here, because it's a fair that represents the individual artists, is actually talk about what the contemporary artists need today, and how we as a community, as individuals, as administrators of the arts, as institutions, can support those needs. So I'll begin by introducing the panelists today, or the, you know, we will be in conversation, so, and I would like to keep that moving very much so, like a conversation. So Kristen, would you like to introduce yourself?
Sure, I'm Kristen Zaremba. I'm the Acting Cultural Arts Manager for the City of Oakland. We're part of Economic and Workforce Development, and I've been with the city for a little over 10 years. My background is predominantly public art, but you know, we embrace all art forms, of course, and support all art in Oakland.
My name is Lordy Rodriguez. I'm a local Bay Area artist. I'm also on the board of ProArts, and yeah, I'm an artist. I have an idea of what I want, at least.
Yes. we'll get to that in 2 minutes.
My name is Dawline-Jane Oni-Eseleh. I am an Oakland-based artist. I do multidisciplinary work out in the Fruitvale.
I'm Nancy Gonchar. Let's see. I have an arts consulting practice. I've been in the arts for many years, first as an artist, then as a curator, then as an arts manager. My most recent position was the Deputy Director of the San Francisco Arts Commission. And so I have broad experience in funding, exhibiting, grant, public art, all kinds of things. So my consultancy, the thing I like to do the best is do interim gigs, like an interim director. And I'm also on the Pro Arts Board. But I'll do anything that you'll give me. Thank you much. In the arts.
Well, thank you so much for introducing yourself. So, I'll start with the artists. What do you guys need today? and be concise.
Be concise.
That's the hard part.
Money.
What do you think, and I was going to say, what do you think, how do you think the needs have shifted and changed today as opposed to even, you know, 5 years ago? Or do you think that that's a relevant, you know, question with technology, with globalization, with how the art market has progressed, and with the notion that we represent Oakland because we are an Oakland-based organization, ProArts. So I'm interested to hear how do you define those needs.
Well, before we answer that, I wanted to ask: is there a difference between what an artist needs as opposed to what an artist wants?
No, I thought that want would be. I thought that need probably would be better for Pam. That's about it. but also reminded me of that. Well, there's a movie with what do women want or something.
Yeah. What do artists want? Yeah.
Go with the wants. If the want is fine. Start with the want.
I think that, well, starting with need, I think that artists today need to develop a sense of community. With more and more globalization and people kind of moving far afield, it's important to stay connected to each other. And that means more than just social media, which I think social media is really great, and I can kind of touch on that a little bit later. But really practically, we need to be visiting each other's studios. We need to be going to each other's shows. We need to keep ears out for opportunities that perhaps don't fit for us, but maybe fit for a colleague. Going to more studio visits, and just, I think in a way, letting go of this idea of scarcity and kind of making everything just for you and spreading it out a little bit more, because I think that if everybody does it, then there's a kind of a reciprocation and a more of a community that keeps progressing.
I think for me, you know, that question comes with the assumption that if we can figure out what an artist needs, we can provide for those needs. Mm-hmm. And I think artists are probably the most resourceful, one of the most resourceful people that I know. I mean, in terms of as a group, I mean, we are natural at problem solving and identifying the problems. So I think, you know, community and having studio visits, being critical about one's own lifestyle, these are things that are, I think, already embedded into the artist practice. But one thing that all artists need fundamentally, I think Fernando, you would hit on it, is collectors. By having an educated collector base out there, or just people willing to go buy artwork from, especially when you're at the beginning stages of your career, is immensely helpful. It creates a very stable way of your having your practice. Mm-hmm. And one way to do that is to go to like an open studio, like the East Bay Open, or Pro Arts Open Studios,
yes.
And you know, look for artists that you've never seen before, and find something within your price range and buy it. You know, last year I went kind of crazy and I just bought as much as I can. But if all of us are out there on a much more larger scale, we do provide that you know, that sustainable financial base for artists to make a living off of. So I think fundamentally that's what we need, more collectors.
I like how you both started with the idea of community, and even as an organization, and we always come back to this idea of community. And with that in mind, because we're talking about either that be a community of collectors, or community of artists, or community of patrons, or a community in terms of a location and space, that's really important, because the whole idea of, I mean, what we all do here is to support art, and to, you know, art is important. That's why we're all here in one way or another, and the people who make art are the artists, so we all need to support that. So with that in mind, Kristen, would you talk a little bit about the idea of community in terms of a location and what you do in terms of city initiatives, new initiatives, and even public art in terms of supporting this idea of community that artists need and want?
Well, it was interesting listening to both of you, and you know, I'm shaking my head and thinking about it, because I do think, I mean, I think you already know that, as you've just expressed it, that community is really important, a part of feeling like you're a part of community, both a part of the community that you live in more broadly, as well as within the artist community. And I mean, I think Oakland comes from a tradition of, you know, community values, really community driven, community based efforts that have nothing to do with the city. You know, like sometimes the city just needs to get out of the way and let those things happen, or just help like smooth the way, right? And one of the things that I really appreciate about starting to work with you is that what we as a city are trying to do is to say, well, here are the resources that we have on hand. I mean, of course, we're always going to be advocating for more money, and we need you as a cohesive arts community to advocate for those things as well, because, you know, just us as staff saying it is never going to be what's compelling to your elected officials. But having that kind of unity and your sense of what your values are and how you can advocate for those becomes, that's important for everyone, no matter what your vocation or your passion, to be able to work together to ask for the things that you need and want. But part of what we try to do is to just be listening and to continue to work internally, and then to reach out to the community about, like, well, let's see, how can we respond to this? So in the last year, of course, there's been a lot of discussion about, for everyone in the Bay Area, about affordability and how do we succeed and thrive and whatever it is that, you know, brought us to the Bay Area, or whether we were raised here or came here from somewhere else, and then how do we as cities support that? And part of it is, again, like pulling together, you know, that I don't want to go off too far down at this end of government, you know, wonky stuff, but that the mayor wanted to convene these housing cabinets to focus on housing issues and what are the needs and what are options, what are different strategies that we could explore for how to respond to that. And classically, you know, the arts needed its own little unit, its own task force, because the arts community's needs are different, and we recognize that, and that it isn't just about housing, it's about housing and workspaces, and what and how do we analyze what's happening in our own city in response to what was happening in San Francisco, and then what we can do to try to help support that. And it doesn't happen overnight, so it becomes a conversation. But as a part of that, one of the things that I really believe in, and it's part of what drew me to public art, you know, I'm an art girl, I studied art history, and I thought I was going to work in museums and do all that. And then kind of go, well, but there's the whole rest of the world and the landscape and what's happening out there. I mean, we know that there, all of us probably will go into those museums, but how do you educate and cultivate, you know, collectors and patrons? It's like you've got to educate everyone and in our midst. And I think part of doing that is public art, with however you define it, lots of different ways to define it, and sort of throwing it back to you, working with organizations like ProArts that have a mission to also support arts within the community, and to, you know, whether it's through the arts in the schools or through the types of programming you're doing and the project that you're getting ready to launch as part of Open Studios, that we've been talking about in the city's trying to help support the work that you're going
artists
to be doing.
Yeah.
Yeah, artists live here. And that is, I want you to talk about it more, but all I'm going to say is that the concept is, let's bring more art like out to our public spaces, out into the City Hall Plaza, which is essentially your front yard, where you're going to have people who don't define themselves as art patrons walking by. And but let's elevate the discussion. You know, like, I love the little, like, sweet, you know, Sunday painter art spare as much as everyone, but let's elevate their concept of how they define art and what the great art is that's out there and how we can cultivate those collectors. So just thinking about it a little bit more broadly and looking for ways to partner with the different organizations and artists in the in our community. So that's my long-winded first thought. but really, I want you to talk more about that, because I'm really excited about what you're going to do too.
Well, the project that Kristen is referring to is we are going to open our 42nd year of ProArts Open Studios the first 2 weekends of June. Again, 42 years of providing this kind of support to artists is sort of like non-hierarchical structure of supporting individual artists on a very large scale, is similar to what StarTup Art Fair is doing, in a way. And we thought, actually, Dulin is a co-organizer and curator of this this project called Artists Live Here, as part of her residency at ProArts, that a lot of the, and that's what I was going in the beginning with, this sort of like have the needs and the wants have changed over time, because we have observed that over the past several years, a lot of the artists who have traditionally participated in Open Studios are not supported to the extent that we could support them. And by that I mean that there's a lot of new media artists and a lot of performance, even, you know, artists. So basically artists who may not have a studio, and either that be because of the economy today or displacement issues or whatever you may say, they don't need the studio space, you know. So how do we support these artists? And we came up with the idea that part of Open Studios, we must provide them with a temporary location, and that location will be a pop-up tent, which will have 14 of those pop-up tents, which will place at City Hall at Franco Gao Plaza in Oakland. And those artists will be part of Open Studios, but at the same time have the opportunity to engage with the public in a way which is non, even to them, like, again, it's not, a lot of these works are sounds or performance-based or time-based media. So so they feel like they have this community and support from the public.
And I just want to say, the feedback we get whenever there is a temporary initiative, you know, something that we get out to the public space, that we always get so much positive feedback and response from the people that either they hear about it or they stumble upon it, and they feel engaged, they feel welcome into the conversation about art and what is art and what inspires you to create what you create, right? And that's what you're talking about. I mean, people love meeting and talking to you guys, you know, because it helps open up for all of us, like, what it is that, you know, how we impart meaning in our lives.
Yeah.
So I think everything that we can do to get more of that, to get it more out into the public space, is really important as a
way of supporting what you do.
Absolutely. Nancy, as a curator, as a long-time curator, how do you think that, well, let me reword this, you know, we talked about collectors, and I think it's very important to collect and support art this way by buying, and you know, for an artist. But I do think that it's also extremely important for artists to be critical to their own work, but also to be critical in terms of having those studio visits by a curator, who is just another way for an artist to test new ideas, to experiment within their own medium and their work, and to get the work out there in the field. So how do you as a curator feel that it's important to support artists today, or
I'm going to segue slightly off of that. Because I was thinking about this as I was driving in today, and having been in the arts for like 30 years. I mean, what do artists need? Artists obviously need to be, they need space, they need resources, which is money often. They do need curators or directors or people that are going to be critical about their work so that it's not just a complete free-for-all. But I think that's one thing that we need in this culture is for arts to be valued as essential. And that's about education, and it also means that education should be arts, science, math, you know, not just science, math, and whatever the E and STEM part is. Anyway. And, you know, there are always arts education programs, but they're always a kind of an add-on,
right.
And an extra. And until it is integrated into the entire culture and into the curriculum as a necessity, we're not going to get all this other stuff at a very deep level, I don't think. But having worked for government agencies like Kristen, where you're constantly trying to figure out what the artist needed, and they said it really clearly. Artists are some of the, you know, both performing artists and visual artists are some of the most resourceful people who learn how to survive on very little, and you know, they need access to things, and they need access to critical thought and have their so that their work is really looked at with a critical eye. They need money. They need space. They need to be integral in creating the community that we're talking about. The institutions, it's all a synergy of everybody working together to do that. So I don't think one thing, it's like which comes first, the chicken or the egg. It's all, and if you look around San Francisco, it's the most vibrant. I mean, how many things are happening this weekend in the arts?
A lot.
I mean, from the major San Francisco art fair to this one being the kind of renegade one to the to the conference going on in Oakland, to the opening of the San Francisco Museum of Modern Art. It's just kind of incredible. So that's my...
Do you feel supported by listening to what we're talking about? Do you feel like your needs are met?
there's that tipping point and like that little extra push, because it is important. One of the biggest things, the most important thing, is to have access to affordable space in which to work. I know I currently don't have a studio right now, and it's very difficult to work on the things that I want to work on without that sort of space. And I was thinking about this kind of in the lead up to this. Having security, whether it's housing or food or, you know, all of these things, leads, I think, to the like experimentation and innovation in the arts, and that's really important to push contemporary art forward, because if you're worried about making ends meet, you're gonna play it safe for the most part, unless you have absolutely nothing to lose, and that's a very rare person. But for most of us, you know, you want to play it safe so that you can have a home to go to at the end of the night. And so I think that accessibility moving forward is gonna be crucial. And in terms of the schools, as Nancy was saying, I was also kind of thinking about the way that we approach arts education from the beginning, I think is gonna be a good thing to think about towards the future in terms of less, like creativity is great, and especially like, you know, call outside the lines or like all of the things that we think of as, you know, arts education, but pushing it forward to talking about the business end and professionalism and approaching arts as a business, so that we kind of start to lose those generations of working for exposure or like, or that kind of thing, so that we can develop a sophisticated way from the very early stages of an artist's career, how to develop like a collectorship and how to put all those things in place. Mm-hmm. Because, you know, there's a phrase that is very popular that kind of irritates me, the whole like, everyone's an artist, they just forget how, like, you know, it's fun and playful, but it also, I think, is detrimental to professional artists, because it's like, oh, anybody can do this. You just forget when you're grown up. Well, there's more to it than that.
There's also a particular way of thinking, of solving problems, of critical thinking that that artists do automatically that could be taught.
Yes.
And it could be integrated with all kinds of subjects, not just isolating the different subjects, but, you know, like design thinking.
But I think art education, I think, is super important, but not just for artists, but for the general public.
No, everybody. Yeah, yeah, talking about everybody.
What you were saying earlier about, you know, art being seen as essential, you know, even till this day, you know, I think I have some level of success in my career, but I'm still a little hesitant when somebody asks me what I do, and I say I'm an artist. But then that usually comes with all the stereotypes and connotations that are associated with that occupation, especially from people who don't know anything about this. And so, like, this general art education, which doesn't exist, I don't think it does. But if there was that, then that does kind of build in a collector base. That does build in this kind of appreciation. So in the long run, that does satisfy the needs of the artist, because it creates, you know, a financial base in which that could stabilize our careers.
So how have you been able to remain an artist in the Bay Area for so long?
If you're an artist, you don't stop.
Of course,
right?
Yeah.
So, you know, like I said, you know, artists are resourceful.
Yeah.
You find ways.
Yes.
And luckily, though, I think
here
in the Bay Area, we have incredible institutional support.
Yeah.
So you can see the kind of stops artists make along the way here in the Bay Area, right? Pro Arts, 2x2 shows.
Yeah.
Headlands. Southern Exposure, there are these institutions that are all around the Bay Area, not just San Francisco, but all around the Bay Area, that support artists. So I think we're really lucky here, but I think it's a lot harder in other cities, especially that don't have that kind of institutional support. And also not to mention the grad schools here. The grad schools here really help a lot.
Yeah.
Well, I think it goes back to, like, you have that that community support of artists and, you know, people that do value to a certain extent, you know, the arts, but it still is the challenge of being in a place where there's so many people that are drawn to that. Then, you know, how do we support everyone here? And yeah, what would it take to make it so you can have that across the country? But I just want to make a little plug based on what you were saying, Dolly, and I wasn't really thinking about it this way, but you know, that whole concept of taking yourself seriously as an artist and treating yourself as a professional. I mean, probably everyone in this room here already, you know, already does that. But we, you know, one of the things that as the city of Oakland we do is also try to talk to our colleagues, you know, in other cities, San Francisco and wherever else in the Bay Area. What are you doing? What's worked for you? What hasn't worked? Like, how can we learn from each other? And not, this was kind of an easy, obvious thing, but one of the things that we hadn't done recently was to offer more sort of technical assistance workshops for artists, individual artists, maybe, you know, ones that are just coming out of grad school, or, and have they really been given any advice about how to operate as a business? So one of the things we're doing this week coming up is called Small Business Week, and Small Business Administration, you know, puts a lot of money and support behind this, and we decided to partner with our colleagues in economic and workforce development, where I work, to think that way, and to have a day that's dedicated to trainings for artists and makers. It started last year with the Maker Movement, which of course is very big in Oakland, and you know, does also support itself as a community. really getting down to the nuts and bolts of thinking about, like, what does it take if you want to operate as a business and you need a business tax license? What type of a business are you going to be? You know, are you filing, not to say, like, give it all to the man, but are you filing taxes as an artist or not? Like, are you in a partnership? Should that be an LLC? What, you know, what does that mean? And then even growing that, you know, this is just the tip of the iceberg, but leading into what type of lease do you have? I mean, we just did this survey and at the end of 2015, and one of the things became clear about artists in Oakland and their living spaces and agreements was that most people are living with month-to-month leases. Mm-hmm. I mean, there's your vulnerability, if ever there was anything. And it's not, you know, because they wouldn't like something more, but it, to a certain extent, it's about how do you negotiate for what you need, right? And what does that mean to say, you know, what, or even if you're going to be part of an arts organization or collective, how do you negotiate for what you need if you find a space so that you have affordable housing for everyone? The city's got a certain amount of that, but, you know, the city doesn't own all the real estate, so we've got to help people to help themselves, essentially. And so I think that is really important, and we see that as being really important as well.
I'm really glad that you brought up about the business aspect, because I was going to bring that up, because I wasn't hearing any of that at all. But as an artist, not only are you an artist, if this is truly what you're doing, it is a business.
Yes. Yep.
And talking about filing taxes and so forth, I know a lot of artists have no clue what they're doing in terms of the business part of it. And it's really important that they understand that, you know, you're just like anybody else selling a product. You know, yes, you have the creative side, but unfortunately you also have to have the knowledge on the business aspect, the business and the marketing aspect.
Yeah.
That's how you get your collectors.
Yeah.
I think when it comes to taxes though, we're all in the same boat. Because we didn't get tax education in normal school either.
Well, that's the other thing. Generally in school, at least when I went to school, there was no such thing.
Yeah.
And that's generally the case. And so you sort of learn as you go along, and that's pretty much the way I learned it. Of course, I did come from a business background, so I sort of had to jump, you know, sort of jumping the gun in when I started my art business. But I still learned a lot from the business and the marketing aspect of being an artist.
Yeah, I mean, well, even about taxes, it's about being smart about how not to pay more.
No, that's the goal.
You have
right?
to, right? Yeah. Well, I mean, we need to support ourselves with our taxes, too. You know, that's how we get our money to help support you. So,
I want to bring it back, though, from the business side back to this, this a little bit more, I guess, hope, you know, like, side about. I always thought that because I've also worked in the arts for a long time, and that's what I was asking about being a curator, is that a lot of the times artists forget that, or not forget, perhaps, especially for emerging artists, even more so than for, you know, mid-career artists, is that you need that one person who's going to be living and give you one show, you know, or give you the opportunity to shine, you know. And I think back to, you know, again, being administrator and being the director of pro arts, I think it's really important to give opportunities to especially emerging artists and contemporary artists and, you know, experimentation, because besides, you know, the business side, which I believe is very important, you do need to have the opportunity to be supported and to be seen first and foremost in the context of a community, and that community being the art community, the art world, you know. And once that happens, then of course, you know, a lot of other things happen along the way that will, you know, will spin to this other, you know, to collectors and sales and so forth and so on. But often it's just this one person who will believe in you and do the studio visit and say, you know what, I think it's going to be great if you're in a group show or if you're in a solo show. And I think that's where it's I was, you know, I was curious to know, when was the first time that you had that experience, Lordy? I mean, was there one person who came to your studio and said, you know what, you will be great, you know?
No one's ever done that.
You'll be great. I think that...
Well, I don't know, because...
Don't artists need that? Don't they need
this inspirational? No, to be honest, I don't think so, because... Mm. Although I do agree with you, it's really important to have that sources of support.
Yeah.
But I think also at the same time that builds up an expectation of what kind of artwork you should be making.
Mm-hmm.
And it takes away that freedom to fail away from you. And I think that's really important. I think for me, it came across multiple shows that I've had growing up. You know, every show that I've had when I first started was incrementally had grown from venue to venue, starting off with a coffee shop and, you know, the stARTup goes on. But
how did you get those shows? That's what I mean. Like, somebody had to give
you
that show.
Again, going back to what you said earlier about community, I was lucky enough to go to high school for the arts in Houston, and there was already that kind of built-in community.
Right.
And again, you know, once you know the kind of steps you should be taking once you graduate, then it's just a matter of applying. But if you don't mind, I just wanted to just tie something back, because you're talking about you know, the creative needs, the critical needs for our artwork to move forward, and now you're talking about the business needs, and both of these are really important, but oftentimes we want to separate them. There's always that line when someone says about selling out, and that usually exists when you start to combine business and your art practice in the way they fundamentally exist. But you know, I think there are ways to incorporate a business practice within the art making process by using entrepreneurial tactics. And I think when we look at a lot of social practice artists, and especially a lot of Bay Area artists, I'm finding, are really good at finding ways of creating alternative economic models within the artwork that they make. So, you know, one of the, I think, prime examples that I always go to is Stephanie Siuko, when she did the Shadow Shop exhibit at MoMA like 8 years ago or something.
I found some pieces.
That was a great way to buy artwork, wasn't it?
Yeah, it was. It was really cool.
But you know, this project of hers had garnered, what, up to six figures worth of profits that it made.
Can you describe that?
What Stephanie did was she created, she recreated the gift shop that was normally on the first floor of MoMA, and she did it on the fifth floor. But instead of having the kind of typical merchandise one has at a museum gift shop, she asked about 300 Bay Area artists to contribute some of their merchandise. And
did she have a price range?
I'm
just curious, because
if she did a gift shop.
There would be a, you know,
kind of price range, you know.
No, but you generally wouldn't see something for like $8,000.
No.
Okay,
so it would
there were some works that were commissioned as prints or short-term prints. Because I remember like Packer Jennings did a really great Vito Conchi sculpture, and he made seven of them, and they were much more higher price point. Now, within Steph's own practice, she didn't take any of the proceeds from this exhibit. But imagine if she did. So if the run of the exhibition brought in more than six figures of profit, that's just the exhibit itself. But the piece itself would be sold separately, like if you were gonna sell it like on the gallery setting. So then it has one layer of finance as opposed to another layer. One layer of finance being that typical transaction one has with buying artwork, right? You buy artwork and you take it. But the experience of the artwork involves another layer of a financial transaction. And if we're able to incorporate some of these kind of entrepreneurial strategies within our own practice, then all of a sudden we don't have to rely on selling our artwork. The mere act of experiencing our own work provides a certain amount of financial income or revenue. So I think there's a nice in between that we can do with this, and you know, this is also kind of plugging myself because I'm the professor of arts entrepreneurship at Santa State.
But that's okay. Everybody's been plugging themselves so far. Go ahead, plug.
We're all excited about her.
But in terms of the curatorial question, I mean, so a curator had to decide that that was an exhibit that they were going to go with,
and
you know, convince the administration at the museum that this was something which was an unusual, you know. So in my curatorial career, I started out doing kind of themed group shows that were kind of my intellectual interests of bringing artists together. And then I decided that I wanted to give one-person shows to mid-career artists to do new work. And that was scary because that was risky because I didn't necessarily know what I would get. And I had to convince people who were above me that that would be, you know. And it usually worked out, but there was often a lot of, you know, finger nail biting when the artist was like a month out and there was no work yet. J- just an idea of work and a whole gallery that needed to be filled.
Yes.
This was a good idea.
but
what you do, so that provides an opportunity for an artist, but it also provides, you know, when you're showing an emerging artist, you're providing a network, your network.
Right.
Yes.
And if you're generous as a curator, then you will provide your network, which might, you'll, because you believe in that artist, you'll suggest that artist to other curators and other museum people or to universities or whatever. And it creates a snowball effect. But the artist has to be willing to get out there.
Yeah.
And artists are often introverts.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, to use a vast generalization. But you have to push yourself to be out there and to avail yourself of those networks.
Yeah. I and going back to this idea of, and now I'm going to plug out again, is the... that we not only give these opportunities in terms of a curatorial platform or sort of like, you know, here, but we do give the space, the curatorial support, you know, and the sort of like the belief. Because we're non-profit, we don't have the accent on the sales because we're not a gallery. But we do give something that is super important that you guys spoke about, artist fees. And this is what we actually provide artists with, fees that are based on wage, talking about alternative models and the fact that artists have to, wage is a organization that started because they wanted to make sure that all artists get paid, because artists very often don't get paid for their labor. So that's why it's W.H., you know, so it's an organization that has collected over time and has a very sort of like, you know, you can print it from their website, guidelines of how you pay for how, like, what artists should get for a solo show, for a group show, for a new project, for something that has been reiterated in a different way, you know. So there's already this format there, but I want to again go back to the ideas that, as you said, you know, they're all integrated with each other. But I do think it starts with this idea that artists do need to know what do they want.
Mm-hmm.
Because, and again, back to the beginning of the conversation, today artists need something completely different than what artists needed in, you know, during Bauhaus, right? You know, or wanted to create. So it has, as times are shifting, the idea even of the studios, as we talked about, has completely changed, you know, over time. Do we need to have studios? For a lot of people, that is not a need anymore, right? And some things at the same time similarly stay the same. Artists will always need an audience, you know, will always need to, you know, communicate some kind of thought or interact with either that with artists or with audiences or with the community. That they create within, and you know, and that's a need, in my opinion, and one that never changes. But again, you know, a lot of has changed in contemporary art. So social practice has once again, you know, recently, you know, participatory art, you know, the need for those artists, you know, the activists and the artists have merged together, so they are not as interested as perhaps, as we talked about, in the business model, or as in, you know, in selling art, because they're interested in a completely different way. But going back, you know, I think there's some very basic needs, and I think that, again, this what I'm hearing, and, you know, maybe we can go again one last time through all the panelists, what would be the one basic need that you think that will never change throughout the time? And I, you know, either that be education or community, what do you think that we can do today to respond to, even if it's that, or to be flexible to this one or two, super important right now in the way that we live today, in the economy climate, in our global, you know, in war, in not war, you know, what do you think is something that will never change, you know, being artists, being administrators, being an institution?
You start.
You
first.
We go this way. Okay, Nancy, you start.
Okay.
Do you think it's...
Well, I kind of where I start with the belief that the arts are essential to our culture and our community, and without them, we're in big trouble.
Yeah.
Without the imagination.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, I think that one thing that will probably never, never change in terms of the needs of artists is the freedom to be able to voice, to give voice to their vision without constraints or sense or censorship.
Yes.
Well, I don't know. I think our industry is constantly changing, but I think that if we remain an unregulated industry, I think the one thing that will never change is kind of an attention gap towards mid-career artists. This may sound a little controversial, I think, but I think that there's a lot of opportunities for young artists now. And looking back at my own career and the shows that were made available to me, were always from the emerging artist point of view. And I think that's great. There should be more, but I think there's already a lot out there. But I look at artists when they get into their midlife, when they start having families and kids. This is where I see the majority of artists stop being artists because they can't keep up with living. I mean, it's hard to do both. And if we remain an unregulated industry, we'll keep on creating a much more larger gap. The same kind of financial gap that we see within income. The more the financial markets have become unregulated, we see a much more larger gap between, a wealth inequality gap. And the art world is a really great mirror for that. So if we remain unregulated, I think that was one that would
probably
never change.
What would regulation look like?
I don't know. I think a lot of people have been trying to propose how to regulate the artwork when it comes to financial transparency amongst the galleries or transparency amongst donors and how that can pull influences amongst collections, collecting institutions, and what they end up collecting and stuff like that. But I don't think there has been any major any laws or anything bringing up a regulation of the art industry. So I think that's one thing I'll never change.
Yeah.
Is support for midlife artists.
It's very interesting because actually I was going to ask about that in particular. You reminded me is that it's recently I was talking to somebody and they were talking about the fact that there's no residencies for artists who have families. Can't ever bring
your
family
yeah.
to residency, and yet there's some millions of people who are in their 40s, 50s with kids and with wives.
That's exactly what they need.
And that's exactly
that
nobody will stop. But and maybe it's space issues. Maybe it's like we don't want to call family here now. And but it's interesting. And I always thought if we start residency that actually supports that, will be really great because there must be a need out there for that.
That's a question. I don't know if there is art base is great. Kayla was originally from art base and I did a residency there and I was in a show there about 3 years ago and it was great. I was able to bring my son and travel to San Antonio and participate in this show. And then also the Headlands, they also have a residency for families, which is fantastic.
I didn't know that.
Yeah.
I did not know that.
Well, they have, well, it's not specifically for families, but they have one of the residencies that accommodates a family of four.
Okay.
There's also a grant, I forgot who it's from, but it's not that much of a grant. I think it's like $1,500 worth of a grant that is meant for artists with children.
Mm-hmm.
But it's limited. But part of that might be, if you're a working artist, it might be hard to pick up and leave for a whole month with the family because the kids are in school and you can't take them out. So
you might not
there's conflicting.
Your family with you.
You
if you're
may
working.
Not want your family.
You might want to just go away for a while.
Bye-bye.
Well, but there are some interesting, topics there that, Kristen, as a city or as a even public art or whatever, city representative, some of those topics are interesting that they always come up, like, the mid-career versus the emerging artists and, payments for work, whether that be through grants or through, institutional support for artists, all of these business models, all of this always like, that's why I was thinking, it's interesting that we can keep having these conversations every year and I bet you anything it will be the same conversation almost because it's some things never change, there'll always be this And I'm hoping that there'll be regulations, because I've worked in the gallery industry, and it's just rampant with mistreatment in a lot of ways of artists. But I'm wondering what the city is responding to some of this. Because it's not just the space and the payments, you know, it's not just grants and space. It's just,
although,
it's so much more than that, you know?
Although I think in some ways, for the city, it's still a learning process, because as you said, it's like an ongoing conversation. And so just, you know, whichever one of those issues you touch on is sort of like, how do we support and express value for the arts? So, you know, whether we have a huge budget or a small budget, that there is still a definitive expressed support for the value of art in our society and our community, and how it is important. I mean, you know, I'm one of those diehard people, I don't know how this room is, but you know, like, how could you ever abolish the NEA, right? I mean, this is how you express as a government, as you know, the elected officials, that this is something that is a value and important to our society. So I think that even though artists might not say they want that, and you know, unless it's like, well, here is a grant, but that it is important for us to constantly reiterate the value of it. And that goes back to what you're saying about arts, you know, education, arts integrated into education, not just as like, oh, here's your elective,
right,
but really how it is something that we value in our culture and what it brings to our society at large. But then it gets down, you know, it is always getting down into the weeds. I mean, you know, what are the space needs?
Mm-hmm.
Part of what we were discussing when looking at, I mean, we said, oh yes, all these people with these month-to-month leases, and that's just horrifying, thinking about how vulnerable people are. On the other hand, for a lot of artists, they don't want a one-year lease somewhere, because they're hoping they are gonna get that residency, right?
Yes.
They don't wanna be paying for space, and they're not in there. They want a nimble, you know, adaptable kind of, you know, space situation. Or maybe you want to be able to, like, keep your things there, go away, and come back and have it be there. It's almost like having your parents' home available to you when you need it, and then you can leave them when you have something else better to do.
Yes.
But, you know, how do we, so that comes back around to what are the policies that we can implement that get really down into, like, zoning issues, and how do you support spaces that help to support artists having families, instead of assuming like, well, if you're going to choose a life of an artist, that means you're on your own. Like, you don't get to have some kind of traditional family life.
Yeah.
And then in the same way, I mean, it's just interesting. That's why I like listening to you guys, that, you know, we're talking about, yeah, here's our workshops for artists who don't even know how to think of themselves as being business entrepreneurs. But that doesn't mean that our mid-career artists don't need support as well.
Mm-hmm.
And so that's where we have to, like, be better at continuing to ask those questions, and then to synthesize the answers and to come up with tools that help to respond to that. But I also think that it goes back, you were asking about public art, and I'll just make a pitch for that, you know, public art is something that, depending on how you define it, but as it has been defined in the past through government agencies as art and public places or art and architecture, it's kind of its own odd animal, and it's only, you know, only so many artists are really interested in doing that kind of work, because, you know, you're dealing with a lot of other issues besides being creative. But for some people, that's part of what they find compelling and what they want to do, and it is a way to make a career, because you can actually earn a real artist fee off of a commission. Sometimes, you know, there are these conversations that happen within government about, like, well, should we just sprinkle that money around everywhere instead of, like, giving one or two big commissions? And, you know, it's an ongoing conversation. I don't think that it's necessarily going to be the same answer always, and our tastes can change, too. Maybe we want to do more ephemeral work, and we want more temporary pieces. Sometimes the funding doesn't let us do that, but I also believe in being able to give artists big commissions and say, take this big project on and create something that's going to have a last, you know, a lifespan that's complementary to the building that, you know, it's associated with. That it isn't just here for today and then it's gone. I mean, you know, it's old fashioned in some ways, but that everyone and the world knows what the Sistine Chapel is and the ceiling is. I mean, that is something that has a lasting presence in people's memories and their, and in terms of their value judgments about art. But I think, you know, there's so many layers to it. And part of it is, again, just making it publicly accessible so that it's something that provokes those conversations. I mean, like, we, you know, we have these conversations every day, but let's get, you know, everyone else into the conversation, right?
Yes, so I would like to, at this point, open it to questions. Anybody?
I got one.
Yes.
To the panel.
Yes.
To piggyback on Natalie, right?
Yes.
Natalia?
Yes.
What you said about you guys having, like, is it one person that ever really backed you and you was like, I can do this? Well, coming, like, where I'm from in Oakland, like, the question applies differently because it's always that one person that never backed you and said you couldn't do this. And I know you all remember that person.
Yeah.
You guys have any stories about that? How to get over that?
Well,
as
an individual artist, I mean, I think about it all the time, and for me, with art, I've always been, like, super tenacious about it, to the point where I know that it's a neurosis, right? Because every, like seriously, I mean, I, first generation kid, art wasn't necessarily something that I was encouraged to do, because it wasn't seen as something that would be able to support me. And it's a struggle every day, but there's different measures of what support is. And for me, I create stuff. And so that supports me in a way that, like, I can always tell when I haven't done any painting for a while, because I get a headache and super grumpy. But in terms of keeping going, all of that stuff comes in from you, because I will say, and I was thinking about this last night. I was here for the opening party, and there's just tons of, like, great people giving lots of great feedback. But the people that don't support your work and say that you can't do something are still not going to support you when you start to do good things. They will run into you, keeping it very vague, but they'll run into you, even if you seem like you're having a great time, and just kind of, like, still give you the weird eye, because they just are weird people. So it's like, you have to, like, dig, you have to have that tenacity. Because for me, my goal has always, I've always had this, like, very closely held set of personal goals in what I want to do. And so listening to all the praise and listening to all the people that aren't supporting you can be detrimental in two different ways. You have to have an inner compass that, like, is set on whatever horizon point. But it is really tricky, because, if you're a person with feelings, it'll hurt your feelings if somebody's like, that you suck or whatever. But those people still are gonna think you suck. Even if you win, like, a Nobel Prize for art that they invented just for you, they're still gonna be like, oh yeah, you're a loser. So
nobody said you guys wanted that. Otherwise,
you know, I should have added
that.
If
you want a Nobel Prize
for art, then
just say it. That was your opportunity.
I don't know. I think those are my favorite people. The ones that flat out hate my work. Because, I mean, it's an effort to hate. It takes a lot of effort.
Yes.
The worst ones are the ones that are totally ambivalent, that just walk and up, and then just continue forward. That's neither supportive or unsupportive. Support, I think unsupport is the same as support when it comes to art. Because, you know, as an artist, we have a tendency to objectively look how people react to things, to objects. And when someone hates something, then there is meat for us to grab onto and try to critically look at. That's important. And so, yeah, those are my favorite people. And, you know, looking back, definitely my mom was totally against me going. She was supportive. She's always been supportive. But, you know, it's that little bit of that unsupport in the beginning that hurts forever. Like, when I first got accepted to art school, and it was a public art school, and so you had to take the bus to get there. But we lived in a region where you had to walk like 10 miles to get to the bus stop. And so, you know, when I told her I got accepted, she goes, well, how are you going to get to school?
That's not support. No.
But I mean, you know, that's the first one. But then other than that, it was other professors that I remember a professor in undergraduate school that told me that my work looked like candy. In a negative way. I mean, you know, this
that's
is,
great.
Yeah, this is, if it were like now, that'd be a compliment. But in the 90s, not so much.
And
he was a huge artist. And I was, you know, he was one of my my most important mentors because he hated my work so much. Mm-hmm. I mean, he still gave me an A in his
what
class.
What's his name?
It's,
oh, you A for effort?
Right. I'm trying to remember. His name is Frank. He's one of the very...
not Stella.
No. But so he's
said it's really.
But he's from the same generation.
Okay.
He's in his 70s. He's African American abstract expressionist artist. Just had a big retrospective in New York, which I don't remember what museum it was at. But really huge. I know. Right?
I'm only asking because we'll call him tomorrow. We'll make sure. No, sorry, I'm joking.
But I still look back at the time That's where funny. He gave me that crit and told me that it looks like candy in it. It hurt my feelings back then, but till this day, I go back to it. So, I think those people are just as important as the supporting ones.
Yeah, that is a good point. I mean, because during my, that kind of reminds me of my my college admissions, and I tell this story frequently, but I literally, my teacher, when I was applying for this very like competitive school, we had to take this home test, and she literally like was like, this is wrong, and like kind of like destroyed the work that I did, and then was like, so-and-so should go to the school instead of you. And I ended up getting in. And, you know, but I still think about that 20, 25 years later.
Yeah.
Still think about Mrs. P, wherever you are.
We'll call her tomorrow.
You call her tomorrow. Please do. Give her my regards.
I was going to say, that would be the next call TV show. I'm calling people that. Thank you for giving us the idea.
Yeah, that's why I think artists are some of the bravest people I know.
it's like
the city.
can't stop, won't stop.
Well, and even for those of us that are like failed artists, you're like, well, maybe I don't have original F ideas. That's not what I should do. You're still in love with it, and you want to find your other some other way to be a part of it.
Yes, too, right?
Like Nancy was saying, you know, it's so.
She
was talking about needing, you know, directors and you know,
I would say I was too judgmental about my own artwork.
Well,
and too practical or too safe.
Yes.
So it was like, oh, I have to make a living.
Yeah.
But I'm sure I had it drummed into me by my parents that art was nice and you can go study art, but you need to. And that neuroses made me really scared.
It's like the whole joke. I don't want to dominate this, but just because it made me think of this, that the joke about when Obama, you know, made the comment about going to studying art history. It's called
the joke.
Horrifying.
That set
us
back a couple of years.
What was the joke? Sorry.
We need more engineers, not more art historians or art critics.
Thanks, Obama.
And you're like, you know, if you thought to say you want to be an artist, you would say yes.
I know, right?
Yes.
But anyway, so it is. It's a mindset. I mean, on so many different levels. Right?
Yeah.
But, so maybe is that what you need? Do you need like just more? Well,
you need just more
validity or
to
believe it in yourself.
And I said, I mean, it comes from within. There's something, and that's like.
Yeah.
It's one of those things where, like, the people that are the most successful may not be the most talented, but they're the most driven and they're the most tenacious.
Yeah.
And so I've had huge setbacks and I've had some good successes, but it's every day you start from fresh and decide to kind of, like, brush yourself off or wipe away the blood, sweat, and tears and keep going even though it literally seems insane because you should try doing something else, like, being an accountant or doing something, you still have to get up and continue to do your work or work through these ideas and maybe listen critically to what people are saying about your work. And that's important. Like, not being delusional and making work that maybe isn't that great because you're obsessed with it.
Yeah.
you know, doing things in a certain way. But maybe that's just a stylistic thing that, like, in the future people will think is gorgeous.
Yeah.
But it's like, but pulling from within yourself and every day deciding to get up and continue to work in this industry because that's all you can do. Like, I don't do it because, like, sometimes I make jokes like, oh, I hate art. But realistically, there's nothing else I can do because that's the way my brain works. It's my skill set. It's the way my arms work. It's really the only thing I enjoy doing and makes me feel whole. So that has to come from inside of you, though.
Yep.
Yeah.
Wow. On that note, on that inspirational note, I'm very thankful to all the for the conversation and all the participants. I'm not going to call you panelists. And I want to especially thank the artists. I see a lot of those panels actually lacking on behalf of the artists,
yeah,
but yet conversing on what artists need and want. So I want to thank the two artists who taught us very eloquently. What we as administrator and non-artists do, I do hope that we'll at least, if nothing else, continue the conversation and continue talking about access, about community, about support, and about education and understanding and appreciation of the arts. So,
okay.
Thank you.
Oh, I remember his name. It was Jack Whitten.
Man,
he's really cool work. I love his work, but
I need to
Jack Whitten. Look him up.